Say, I'd like to ask you to what you credit your success. You've been working successfully in your chosen field for many years in many different kinds of roles.
I always said you'd be rich and famous one day.
I would say, I would attribute a woman named Monique James, who was head of talent at Universal Studios, took me from behind a secretary's desk and put me in front of a camera at 27 years old. I started very late. But because of her guidance and her judgment in picking projects for me, I just seem to have, the career seems to have sustained. And I give her really all the credit for it. She's gone now. But when the universal contract system ended, she left the studio and became my manager for 20 years, just the two of us. She never had another client. And I learned through her about, you know, what projects are right for me and what will hopefully take me on to the next project. And
you were right.
I don't know. I've just been very, very fortunate. I mean, I'm in a series now that, I don't know, but it's the highest rated cable show in the nation. Burn Notice.
Yes, so I've read, yes.
And I don't know how I got it. I think one job leads to another.
My name is Michael Weston. I used to be a spy until...
We got a burn notice on you. You're blacklisted.
A burn notice, if you and I got fired, we'd get a pink slip. When you're fired from the CIA, you're given what is called a burn notice. And you no longer exist. Your bank account disappears. You can't get anyone to return your call. And that is the storyline in the case of our lead, brilliantly played by Jeffrey Donovan. And he's dropped down into, he wakes up in a hospital room in Miami, which is the last place he wants to be because that's where his mother is.
Is that your mom again?
So, I play the mother from hell. Not really. Interestingly enough, my son's name in this is also Michael.
I understand you have some very good material to work with in this television series.
I do. I play...
good writing.
Wonderful writing. Matt Nix is the at the helm. He's very, very young, and he hit pay dirt his first time out. So I'm just in awe. And we are the number one cable show in the nation, and because it's so, so clever. I mean, he has to use whatever materials are at his disposal to make bombs or to get out of situations. And it's a very smart, smart show. And yet it's funny too. Sometimes we're the number one show in the country, but we can't get an Emmy nomination. And they say it's because we're a crossover show. It is an hour drama, but some of it is also very fun.
You know, as a gay man, I got to tell you, I miss watching you on Sunday nights on Queer as Folks. You brought up the character of Debbie Novotny. She was the epitome of the word outspoken. Outrageous, yes. It always came from a place of love, though, didn't it?
It did. I've had people come up and say, oh, gosh, you know, I wish I had a mom like that. And I'd say, well, thank you. Or they'd say, my mom's just like you. I'd say, I'm so sorry. when I got that part, I tried to, I didn't have to try. My mom, I had the best mom. And nobody let up when I walked in a room like my mother. And I always remembered that. And I thought, I know what that feels like to be the recipient of that love. And I remember she wasn't wacko at all like Debbie. My mother was actually quite conservative. But I always remembered that heart connection between the two of us. And so I knew that kind of love was possible, and I just put it into Debbie for Michael.
You know, Sharon, since this is a website and podcast designed for the specific interests of LGBT people, I got to ask, why have you been so good to us, bringing these characters to life and making personal appearances at events like LGBT film festivals and the GLAAD Awards? I've seen you at the GLAAD Awards. I think we owe you a debt of gratitude.
Well, I'm not just saying this. I'm glad you asked me this question because I feel like it is I who owe you the gratitude. When I got Queer as Folk, you know, I was sailing along in my career and, you know, playing the leads here and there. And then when I hit 50, my career stopped. television didn't want a woman my age or my size at that time. And Queer as Folk put me back on the map. And I am forever, forever, forever grateful. And before that, a lot of my success on Cagney and Lacey was due to the lesbian community. They loved Chris Cagney. And I think that was the initial thrust, so to speak, of my success was the support of the lesbian community. And then the gay community brought me back. And so I guess I earned my stripes where I finally got to play Hannah. But it is I owe you the gratitude, because I really feel the gay community has kept me going.
All right, then I must ask, any chance there could be a Queer as Folk reunion or yet another Cagney and Lacey reteaming?
I don't know. Cagney and Lacey did four reunion movies, which just came out on DVD, by the way. So I don't know if there'll be a reunion, another reunion movie with Tyne and me, but there is some talk of people wanting to do a feature. I think we're ready for a reunion on Queer as Folk. I think it'd be fabulous. It'd have to be like in a movie, TV movie form.
Right. Good for you, Sharon. Our guest
I'm
today,
very
Sharon
fortunate.
Gless, star of Burn Notice on, is that USA?
It's USA.
Thank you, Sharon.
Thank you, Steve.
In light of today's guest, I want to leave you right now with a quote from the late, great Sir Ralph Richardson, who once said of acting, "It is an art which consists of keeping the audience from coughing." Humbly yours, I'm Steve Kmetko for mycommunity.com. Thank you.